Hello everyone, welcome back. My name is Cruiser Complex, and today we're going to be talking about how to play the engineer in Valve's Team Fortress 2 Man vs. Machine game mode. This is one of, if not the most difficult classes to play in MvM. It is incredibly micro-intensive. I do not recommend playing engineer in MvM unless you are significantly experienced with other classes. It's hard, and you have one of the largest impacts on the flow of the game of absolutely any class in the game. If you go down, the rest of your team is almost certainly going to follow. Don't get me wrong, it's incredibly fun, but you also need, you require certain weapon unlocks to play effectively. You need to have excellent map awareness. Your upgrades are incredibly important, some of them absolutely crucial. This is an ordeal. It is a lot like playing a spreadsheet in some ways. And so on that note, let's get into the weapons that you need to play engineer effectively. Here's a quick overview of the weapons that I use on my engineer loadout. This tutorial is going to be correct as of spring 2018. For your primary weapon slot, Rescue Ranger. There's really no two ways about it. The Rescue Ranger is by far and away the single most amazing primary weapon you can use in MvM as an engineer by a significant margin. It was even better before the Jungle Inferno update, which made it cost metal when you repair from range. That was a nerf, but it's still by and large the single best primary weapon you can use as an engineer. What's it competing with? Your stock shotgun? Your sentry gun is going to be doing all of your damage. This is going to do fuck all. Don't even... No. You need this. The ability to right-click to pull your gun to you for 100 metal is amazing. You absolutely need it. Panic attack, what a joke. The Frontier Justice, total meme. Just ignore it. If your gun goes down, hooray, you've got crits, but your gun's down now, and that gun was dealing 99.999% of the damage that you were dealing, and you don't have that anymore. So your absolute number one priority should be getting that gun back up. Not having it is a big deal. Widowmaker, what a joke. Bonus damage towards whatever your sentry's shooting, your sentry's just going to kill it. Don't worry about it. You should not be dealing damage with your primary weapon as an engineer. Pumps, like any primary weapon, is going to deal bupkis damage compared to what your gun is going to put out. So just ignore that you have a primary, except for the Rescue Ranger here. Secondary weapon, the Wrangler. Super good. Short circuit, it's a total meme. Much like the Pyro's Air Blast, you're never going to be able to short circuit enough projectiles to make this worthwhile, but this will save your gun more often than not. The pistol's crap. For the same reason that you don't run a primary weapon for damage, the pistol is garbage. The Wrangler lets you A, shield your gun from a lot of damage that would have otherwise been fatal, and B, target robots that you need to pick, or more importantly, don't target robots that you don't need to shoot, i.e. medics. A lot of this tutorial series has been focused on who can and can't deal with medics. There was a big to-do in the original video about if you're not the pick class, don't shoot medics. The sentry gun shoots indiscriminately most of the time. Whatever target is closest, it will target. And as a result, if it sees a medic, it will typically shoot a medic, and that's bad because it will pop the medic and the robots will gain a vulnerability and it cascades. It's bad. By pulling out your Wrangler, you prevent the gun from shooting long enough for your pick class to kill the medics, and then you let the gun do its thing. If there's a giant medic, which remember that you do want to shoot because they always run the quick fix, you can use the Wrangler to specifically target the medic instead of its heal target. Your gun will naturally prioritize the heal target before the medic because the heal target drops down first, and like I said, the gun will typically shoot whatever it sees first. Which is the heal target. You can use the Wrangler to circumvent that, help your team kill the medic, and then let the gun do its thing. Also, the Wrangler makes the gun shoot slightly faster, if I'm not mistaken. It also chews through ammo, so, you know, take it as it comes. Your wrench is really your primary weapon most of the time. The Eureka effect is a joke. The teleport effect is completely useless. The minus 20% metal from pickups and dispensers is a death sentence, since you need tons of metal. you need so much metal as an engineer. The gunslinger is an absolute joke. Absolutely never take it. The whole reason you're running engineer is for the sentry gun, more or less. I mean, your other buildings are extremely useful, but if you don't have a level 3 gun, you're dealing absolutely no damage, so you're kind of dead weight. The southern hospitality is sure, why not? The bleed is absolutely meaningless. The no random critical hits is kind of a bad thing, though, because if you're forced to deal with a spy by yourself, you'll very, very likely get a crit if you're running the stock wrench, because your gun has dealt so much damage. And of course, the percentage that you are likely to get a crit is based on how much damage you've done recently. So because your gun has dealt so much damage, you're very likely to get a melee crit, which won't happen if you run the Southern Hospitality. And the negative 20% fire vulnerability on Rare is usually never an issue, but, you know, the stock is almost always better than the Southern Hospitality. The Jag isn't bad, but you should still run the stock for a couple of reasons. One, building speed in MVM doesn't really matter, and I can very quickly show you why. Guns build instantly in setup time. They don't when the wave starts, though. If you try to build a gun outside of setup time, you will have to build it from scratch. However, that takes a lot of time and can be circumvented by spending $50 on a building upgrade canteen, which you should always have at least one of in your pocket, because they're incredibly useful. If your gun goes down, your number one priority is getting it up quickly, but the Jag isn't really going to help you build it quickly enough to justify using it over the stock, because the Jag, as you can see here, has minus 33% damage penalty towards buildings and the 20% slower repair rate. It's almost always better to fix a gun that you already have built than it is to build a new one from scratch. The minus 33% damage penalty towards building basically means if a spy puts a sapper on there, it takes one extra hit to knock it off. Usually not a big deal at all. One of the upgrades that you can buy as engineer is plus building health, so it takes forever for a sapper to take your gun down. That's almost never going to be a consideration. It's just an annoyance. The nail in the coffin, as it were, for the Jag is the lower repair rate. Like I said, almost always better to just repair a building that you have than it is to build a new one from scratch. Because the time that it takes you to build a new one and upgrade it while it's under fire, because it's going to be shot at. It's the sentry gun. It's going to take fire. It's designed to take fire. It's going to take so long that it's worth spending $50 to have the ability to just build one instantly. With that said, let's get into the upgrades that you need to buy to do your job as engineer effectively. Here we are in the upgrade station on Rottenburg. We're going to talk about the upgrades that you need to play engineer effectively. When you first spawn into the wave, you should get as much dispenser range as humanly possible. 3 is almost mandatory. In some very fringe cases, I take 2 points, but we'll get into that in a minute. You'll want to max this out as soon as humanly possible. The reason for this is when you put your dispenser down, normally you have to stand it like right inside your engineer, either you or your teammate, in order to get the benefit from it. But if you have dispenser range, you can see that the healing beam is all the way. I can be this far away and still get the benefit from it, meaning if I get shot at by a rocket, the dispenser is nowhere near the splash radius, which means you don't have to spend time healing it. Your team can be away from it. They don't all group up on something that's healing them and then get taken out by a crit. It's incredibly useful, especially for the heavy, if you watched that last video. The next thing that you're going to want is at least 1 point in metal capacity. That's incredibly important, because you'll notice if I bring up my... Let's start the wave so that I get the metal count properly. We'll just restart afterwards. You'll notice that the metal costs for my buildings are sentry gun 130 and dispenser 100. If I have 1 point in metal capacity, I can put down both of these, and then if I have a building upgrade canteen, I can upgrade them both instantly. I couldn't do this with only 200 metal, because 120 plus 100 is, of course, more than the default 200, but with 300 metal, I can do this and have some metal to spare. Back at the upgrade station for more upgrades. After you purchase your dispenser range and 1 point in metal capacity, you're going to want to start pouring all of your money into building health as quickly as possible, because the amount of damage that your sentry can soak is Very important. You'll remember that when I was talking about the usefulness of the JAG, I said that it's better to fix a gun that is already built but damaged than it is to build a new one from scratch. And getting more building health helps you do that significantly. Never, ever, 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 ever purchase this disposable sentry. It's expensive, it deals no damage, it's a lot more micro on a class that's already micro intensive, and it eats metal. It takes 100 metal to put it down, which with 1 point of metal capacity is 30% of your upgrade. That's a lot. You can heal your primary gun by a lot by doing that. That's two building upgrade canteens. After you finish buying building health, dispenser range, and some points in metal capacity, you'll want to purchase maybe 1, maybe 2 points in attack speed on your wrench. You'll want to do that because the faster your wrench swings, the faster you can repair your buildings. Because each time you hit the building, you put metal into it, and if you swing faster, you do that faster. I usually only take 1 point in it. You can also purchase 1 point in clip, 1 or 2 points in clip size, and maybe a point in firing speed on your rescue ranger because it's incredibly cheap. This is a little bit controversial. Some people will tell you that the wrench is strictly better, but I think that a little bit of clip size and a little bit of firing speed that lets you repair your gun from range is very good. But keep in mind that this is even more micromanagement in the most micromanagement intensive class in the game. So if you want to put more on your plate, I think this has more utility than this. But they're both valid options. I wouldn't go for both. I would either pick a little bit faster swing speed on your wrench or a couple of points into these two upgrades. One of these is how you're going to be repairing your gun, the other one, not so much. You decide. The Wrangler, of course, has no upgrades. After you finish purchasing building health, dispenser range, metal capacity, and slightly improve the way that you repair your weapon, your gun, you're going to want to buy some resistances, of course, blast resist, bullet resist, crit resist. I also very much like at least 1 to 2 points of movement speed on engineer because you do actually have to move around a significant amount. Because some of the jobs that you have to fulfill are area denial via the gun. You'll have to move the gun around, and the rescue ranger isn't going to be able to do that all the time. So the ability to move you and your gun or your buildings out of harm's way is extremely helpful. A single point in health regen can be good because you're not going to be down in the pit with the medic very much, so you are kind of responsible for your own longevity. However, because you're not in the pit with the medic and really far back, you won't be getting shot at so much. So even 1 point of health regen can be extremely economical. Metal regen, I think, is kind of a trap because you never regen this very quickly and it's easier to just buy a couple of points of movement speed, run, and go get a stack of what turns out to be 200 or 300 metal because you've increased your maximum metal capacity, and the amount of metal that you get from metal packs is dependent on your maximum amount that you can have. So a couple of points of movement speed lets you go get a small ammo pack that ends up being like 200 or 300 metal. Whereas this gives you a small amount of metal that will repair your gun, maybe one hit's worth of your wrench every few seconds. I think it's a trap. Some people might try to convince you otherwise, and maybe they're onto something, but I've never found much use out of it. Fire resistance is crap, and so is jump height. Not incredibly useful. Jump height also really can mess with how well you can sentry jump. Just take my word for it. So it's usually not a good idea to buy that. With that in mind, let's get into the micro that I keep talking about. Buildings, building placements, how to move them, how to know where to put them, the best places for them, and the advantages and disadvantages of various places. See you there. Okay, here we are at the bomb on Rottenburg. This is going to be a tutorial for how to place your buildings and where. You're going to want to put your teleporter down right here. Don't put it too far this way. Don't put it too far this way. Don't put it like up on here because it'll get shot at. What you want to do is put it right in this. There's a little groove right there. I don't know if you can see it, but the ground contours in such a way that there's a little dip in the ground. Put your teleporter right there so that somebody walking to it hops directly up on it. You should be able to do that and not get caught on it and have to jump. It's an annoyance. The other end of your teleporter is going to go usually right here in what's called the tower, so-called because it's a tower. You'll want to put it On this side, I mean, you can put it over here. It really doesn't matter. Just make sure that you rotate it so that the somebody stepping out of the teleporter will be facing this way. They come through it, they can jump right off the tower and get right back into the fray. If you don't put the teleporter there, you're going to want to put it here next to the pitchforks, like right there, so that somebody will come out. They'll be on the teleporter, they can come right out into the fight. The advantages of this is that it's much closer to what's called the front, i.e. where your team is fighting. Also, if you get the upgrade called two-way teleporters, which I forgot to talk about in the upgrades portion, two-way teleporters is an upgrade that does exactly what it sounds like. Both of your teleporters are both entrances and exits. If somebody steps on the exit, they get teleported to the entrance, and if somebody steps on the entrance, they get teleported to the exit. I.e., you can use this upgrade to teleport yourself from the front, step on this, go all the way back there so that you can buy upgrades mid-wave. This is an upgrade that you should ask your medic, usually, or maybe your demo. Is this something that you want? Because those are the two classes that use canteens the most. If they say no, I'd give it a pass until you have enough money to afford it. It's something that you'll definitely want in the last wave, though, because almost everybody buys a lot of canteens on the last wave. If not, give it a pass. But anyway, that's the advantage of putting your teleporter here. It's good for two-way teleporters, and it's really close to the front. The advantages of putting your teleporter up there is that it almost never, ever, ever gets shot at. Ever. It's extremely safe, and it's not that much further back from the front. Maybe 1.5 seconds worth of walking. That's about the only two places you're ever going to put a teleporter. Let's talk about the more important buildings now, quote-unquote, of the dispenser and the sentry. Now, depending on how aggressive you are, or how far your team gets pushed back, or how skilled you or your team are, that's all going to impact where you put your buildings. By and large, the default spot to place your dispenser on Rottenburg is going to be right here. Try to get it as close to where I put it as possible, on this polygon right here. The reason that you want to do that is because when robots drop down from over here and they're shooting right there, the placement of the dispenser is going to be such that if a rocket explodes right here, your dispenser is going to be outside of the blast radius. But if you have dispenser range, which I don't right now, I bought movement speed for so I could walk up here faster. If you have dispenser range, your heavy is going to be able to get the benefits of the dispenser from where it is right now. So it's the best of both worlds. You don't take damage. It doesn't get trampled by giant robots. If a giant scout comes through here, like I said in the heavy video, he's going to be hugging this rock, try to go this way, and if he gets blocked, he'll go around. He won't trample the dispenser. If a giant robot steps on a building that is not the sentry, it will immediately get destroyed. This is bad. Pardon me. Also, if a sentry buster comes down and the heavy is dumb enough to shoot it, don't shoot sentry busters, kids. Nothing good comes of it. If a sentry buster comes down and the heavy shoots it, it will probably get destroyed if he maintains fire on it about in here. And that can be enough to destroy your dispenser if it goes off there. The benefits of having a dispenser here are it lets your team fight very close to where the robots drop down, and as a result, they don't suffer very highly from damage falloff, especially the heavy. It lets them shoot there, it lets them shoot there with relatively low damage falloff. If you don't put the dispenser there, you're going to want to put it behind this secondary rock, about right there. You want to make sure that you put it far enough away from right here so that it doesn't get hit by splash damage by incoming rockets. That's going to be the theme of where you put your dispenser. Put it in such a in a place where your team can benefit from it thanks to dispenser range 3, but where it doesn't take damage from incoming explosives. And it shouldn't take very much damage here. If you don't put it there, if there are lots of robots coming from the right, then you can put it here. And if you have dispenser range 3, you can get the benefit of it by standing right here, and that's what the heavy will sometimes do. And that can be good for you, because a lot of the times you're going to want to be putting your gun right here. More on that when I talk about the gun. And you can get quite a good benefit from your dispenser as well, and keep your gun healed up with your rescue ranger. That about sums it up for dispenser spots on the front. You'll want to try to keep it there for as absolutely long as possible. If you must, you can move it back to right here. And a good thing about right here, especially on Hamlet, is you tend to get pushed back inside the tunnel quite a lot. Inside the tunnel being anywhere back here, outside the tunnel being anywhere out here. Because of the crit soldiers that you see on the top right, they're the soldiers with the yellow banner, a lot of your team's going to die to that, especially if your soldier isn't running buff banner. So you're going to need to pull the dispenser back. If you put it up there, it can take a lot of damage from the soldiers that come from the top right. So you can put it there preemptively. When you have to fall back inside the tunnel, it's very easy to right-click, throw it down. This is where the dispenser goes if you get pulled back inside the tunnel. Your heavy can stand here, still getting benefit from the dispenser. He doesn't take damage from most of the soldiers that drop down from over there. This is where it goes. If you get pushed back much farther, it's really hard to decide where to put the dispenser. Here's an okay spot. It doesn't get shot at so much from up there. If you get pushed back even farther, which is starting to get kind of bad, you can put it right there. Your heavy will get benefit from it from standing like right here. If you get pushed back even farther, you can put it up here. And if you get pushed back any farther, you're pretty much at spawn. The place that you put it is right here next to the teleporter. That's about all the spots that the dispenser goes. Anywhere that's behind some cover that your team can congregate and peek out of cover while still getting the benefit of the dispenser range 3. And the range of dispenser range 3 will quickly become intuitive once you get used to it. With that out of the way, let's talk about the gun. Here we are back at the front of Rottenburg. We're going to talk about where you need to put the sentry as engineer. What I see a lot of new engineers doing is putting the gun here, and that's acceptable, but it's very aggressive and it will get spammed out very quickly. Most of the robots that you fight on this map are going to drop down from right here, and so the first thing that they're going to see is very likely going to be the gun. They're going to spam it out, and they are definitely going to be able to spam it out faster than you can heal it in almost every instance. It's going to go down very quickly. And what I see happen a lot is new engineers build their nest that looks like this, where they put the dispenser right here as they would in casual so that they can sit here and whack their sentry like they're a free-to-play that doesn't know anything about building placement. Sorry to go Porky Pig there. Some demos drop down, they lob some grenades over there, and then the whole nest goes down in one fell swoop. Don't do that, kids. Like I said, your dispenser should realistically be over here, behind the rock. It doesn't get shot at very much. And then your gun should be somewhere down in the pit to support your team. Here is a pretty good place because it allows you to body block. If you watch the heavy episode, then you know that body blocking is when you place either a building or your physical body in such a way that things can't walk past it. So you'll have the giant scouts drop down, they'll run this way, and they'll try to fit through this gap, but won't be able to. It'll take them a few seconds to figure that out, and only then will they walk around it. And if you want to body block effectively, you need to make sure that there is not quite enough space for you to fit through, maybe just enough because scouts are a little bit bigger than you. What you don't want to do is put the gun right up against the edge, because they'll figure out very quickly that they can get around it. Leave enough of a gap that they think they can get through, but they can't. The benefits of this gun placement is that it's very close to the front, it does a lot of damage. The negatives are it can get spammed out kind of easily. Where I usually put my gun is right here. And you'll notice that I was fairly exact with that, I didn't just plop it down. That's because this is another crucial body block place. You want giant scouts can get body blocked here. You put your gun about right there, maybe slightly more forward. They'll come around this rock, they'll come right here, they'll try to path through here, they'll get stuck, and they'll be stuck for a few seconds, which gives your team or your gun enough time to kill them, and then when they finally figure out that they can go around, they're usually dead. If not, you should be behind the gun, anticipating them to run around your sentry and do one of these. Pull it back, put it down. This is another body block spot. where the scouts will come through here, they'll try to path right here, get stuck again, and by that point, they should definitely be dead because they've been blocked two or three times, probably twice by your sentry and once by the heavy. This isn't a good spot for anything except blocking scouts because, as you can see from this red targeting area right here, most of the map is outside of your reticle. But if I put it here, you'll see that any robot that gets past the rock is going to be able to be shot by the gun. And that's pretty good, because your team should be able to deal with most of the things that scoot down here. If you've ever watched Uncle Dane, then you'll have heard him use the term area denial. And that's what your gun is here. It's a safe place for your team to fall back to, if I'm allowed to parrot the man. Anything that gets past your primary team's damage is going to be picked off by the gun. Your gun is not meant to be a primary damage dealer, however, you will end up with a lot of damage because your gun has an aimbot and does a significant amount of damage, just from mopping up the things that get through. If your team gets pushed inside the tunnel, pick it up, and you'll want to put it about right here, maybe a little bit more off to the side, like right here. Ideally, you want it to be able to target the tunnel, but it shouldn't be able to be seen when the robots drop right there, because they will see it and they'll shoot it and they'll spam it out from long range way before it can target enemy robots. So slightly off to the side so that it can target things coming through the tunnel, but that it doesn't get spammed out. If you get pushed back inside the tunnel, it's going to look something like this. Your dispenser is going to be like right in here somewhere so that your heavy can get the benefit of it, or your heavy classes, whatever they are. You're going to be somewhere in this area. You could also be over here. It's a little bit more awkward because the only metal you have available to you is this medium health kit or medium metal pack over here. And it's more difficult for you to run away because you need to either go through here, which doesn't leave you in a good spot because it's a long way to get back to where your team is from here, or more realistically, you'll run up these stairs. But then you also have to cross the line of sight of the robots that you were just trying to get away from. So this is usually the spot where you put the gun if you get pushed back inside the tunnel. If you get pushed back any farther, you can put the gun here. You can put the gun like right here. Again, your dispenser is going to be like right here. The idea is much the same as it was for the tunnel. You want it to be able to shoot things that are coming across the bridge, but no further than that. Just like in casual, you don't want the gun to be able to see anything that it can't shoot if you can help it. It needs to be close enough to the front to be useful. It's a safe place for your team to fall back to. Any scouts or anything that comes across this bridge that your team fails to kill, your gun's going to get them. Barring that, again, you're setting up on last. If you have the dispenser up there, you can have the gun somewhere in here to mop up things that come through. Or if you're forced to set up on the last point, am I going to die from fall damage? No, I'm not. You're going to put the gun somewhere in here so that it can shoot things that are coming across the catwalk or whatever you want to call this. But it's not going to be seen by robots walking across the bridge over there. That's gun placement in a nutshell, but it's only one map. I'll see you on Manhattan. Okay, here we are in Manhattan. First, we're going to talk about teleporter placement, as always. Where you want to put the teleporter on Manhattan is right here, about equidistant between these two doors, so that teammates that spawn on this side can get to the upgrade station if they need to, immediately turn and get into the teleporter. If they spawn on this side of the room, which is more likely, then they'll come here, they'll go through the teleporter, and go to the other end of the map. This is a fine placement. I know that you can see it from a long ways away, but if the robots can see this, you've probably lost the wave anyway. It's more important that your teammates can get to the front quickly than it is to hide this from damage. This is almost never an issue until you've lost the wave anyway. Where you want to place the other end? You want to place the other end of this teleporter right here behind these barrels on the top of these crates. This makes it so that your teammates can step onto the teleporter, come through it, turn, and almost immediately be in the fight. Another place that you can put it that's more aggressive and very useful if you have two-way teleporters, if your team has requested it, is right here. It almost never gets shot at right here. Your teammates will be standing right in this area because your dispenser is almost always going to be right here. We'll talk about that in just a minute. If they need to go back to spawn for whatever reason, they just come right here, step into the teleporter, and boom, they're at spawn. And that's really the only two places that your teleporter should ever be. You could put it right here, maybe, if your team gets pushed back to the first gate and you still want to have that two-way teleporter utility. That way, when your team is congregated right here, they can come back here, step into the teleporter, and go back to spawn. But this is usually never an issue, and in my 130 tours, I've had somebody make use of this that wasn't myself, maybe twice. Most all of the time, your teleporter is going to be up on top of these crates behind these barrels. One thing that I do want to point out quickly is if your teleporter is up here and you get pushed back to the first gate, meaning the robots capture this gate, what you're going to want to do is pick this up and move it to like right here, because your gun is probably going to be up in this region somewhere. And if a sentry buster comes after your gun, he'll come up here, he'll walk over here, and then if he explodes right here, that's going to be in range of your teleporter and your teleporter is going to go down. But if you move it to this position right here, it'll be outside the area of effect. That pretty much does it for teleporters. 9 times out of 10, it's going to be right here. Right here. And if you get pushed back and you need to put a gun up, then just move it a little bit to the back. Now let's talk about dispensers. I see a lot of new engineers putting the dispenser right here, and they build the gun right here. Because, again, just like I said in the Rottenberg map, they're still in that turtle engine mode where they can sit right next to their dispenser and hammer away on their sentry without hardly ever moving. This is bad. That's a good way to get your whole nest destroyed and you with it, because you are a lot less tanky than your sentry gun, especially when you get the max health on your gun. Also, buildings take no critical damage, and a lot of enemies in Man vs. Machine are critical enemies. You'll see in the top on the UI there, one of the first things that comes down is a giant Sandman scout with criticals. The flashing blue around their name means that they have permanent crits. Your gun's really good at dealing with that because they don't take critical damage. It will one-shot you. It will one-shot any class in the game at the start of a map. That's just the way that enemy is. What you'll want to do with this dispenser instead, because it's not for you, it's for the team, is put it right here, behind this pipe, or barrel, or whatever it's called. It will almost never get shot at here, unless your team decide that they need to stand right here to get the benefit from it. But you're going to have dispenser range 3. So they don't have to stand here. They can stand here. I don't have dispenser range 3 because I got two-way teleporters and stuff for the sake of this video, but trust me, if you had dispenser range 3, you could get the benefit from here and it wouldn't take splash damage. Alternatively, if you don't think that there is a good idea, you can put it like right here on this button and it shouldn't get targeted. TM. It shouldn't get targeted. I don't like to trust the AI not to shoot this, but it works. I know it works because I've seen it. As long as your teammates don't stand right next to it or try to use it as an element of cover, it won't take damage. Another place that you can put the dispenser, if you're extremely cautious, is like right here. And your heavy can get the benefit of it. He can stand next to this crate and shoot and still get the benefit of this dispenser. And that's really the only places that you ever want to put a dispenser down here in the pit. If you get pushed back, because they cap A, the dispenser goes in front of the notice sign right here so that your team can congregate around it. The heavy can stand right here, shoot up into the gate while still getting the benefit of your dispenser. If you get pushed back even further, this starts to get bad because the number of places that you can put a good building are, they start to dwindle. I like to put it here behind this. It's gonna take damage. Just anywhere that you can put a building when they cap B is not a good place. If you don't want to put it there, then you can put it here. Again, it's going to take damage, and if a giant comes through here, it's definitely going to trample this. The ups and downsides of putting it here versus there is that here it's going to get spammed out by smaller robots, and here it's going to get trampled by a big robot if your team fails to do it. Or fails to kill them. If you get pushed back all the way to spawn, either side of the either side of the road here is good, either there or there, but at that point you're kinda boned. This one isn't really like Rottenberg, where there are a number of places that you can safely fall back to and still hold. Things start to... This map gets progressively harder and harder and harder to hold, especially from an engineer standpoint, the further you get pushed back. So the more losses you take early on, the more that has the potential to go very badly for you as the wave continues. With dispenser placement out of the way, let's talk sentries. Sentry placement on Manhattan is significantly more involved than it is on Rottenburg, simply because you need to be more proactive about blocking scouts than you do on Rottenburg. On Rottenburg, your heavy scout soldier will be in position to block scouts more effectively than they will be on this map. On Manhattan, you are almost the primary blocker slash slower of scouts. Your scout will be able to help you with Mad Milk, and your soldier will be able to help stun, but they won't be able to do it alone. You have to physically block scouts on this map or else they will overrun you, and you are the class to do it. Other classes assist you on this map, not the other way around. So, with that said, most of the time your gun is going to be sitting where it is right now next to this caution tape. It's far enough out of the way that it's not the first thing robots see, but it can still shoot most of the things down in the pit, and it'll shoot things as they start to get past your team, it'll shoot things as they come up the ramp, it can shoot things that come down here. This is a really good spot for your gun. Doubly so, because if you put your dispenser right here, and you have dispenser range 3, you can get the benefit of your dispenser by standing about right here, provided you have dispenser range 3, which is really good. Also, you have these two health and metal kits all to yourself. Sometimes the soldier or scout will take them if they're not thinking or being inconsiderate, but they are designed for your use. So yeah, most of the time your gun is going to be right here. However, if you need to go into block mode, and in order to know where to put your gun, you're going to need to have either map awareness or map familiarity. Scouts come from both down there and up there on the catwalk. That structure is called the catwalk on this map. And it can be difficult to know which ones come from where until you're just familiar with when and where they come. You can see them a little bit ahead of time. If a scout spawns up there, you will usually be able to see its outline or see it coming down the ramp first. And so you'll have until it gets from there to these stairs to act, and if it spawns there from Gray Man's Machine, whatever that's called, the mobile command unit, whatever, you'll have from the time that it spawns in that hangar bay until the time that it drops down to get your gun into position. If the scouts are coming from the catwalk, you will want to put the gun right here. Again, just wide enough so that the scout will think that it can get through here, but it's not able to. You'll want to put it... That's probably about as good as it gets. The idea is to get the scout stuck on the gun for long enough for your soldier to spam it out, or long enough for your scout to slow it, and your gun to subsequently deal with it. Your gun can't deal with the scouts by itself. It can block them, but it can't kill them alone. That's why your soldier will have to jump up and help deal with scouts as they are coming. Another place that you can block guns, or block guns rather, block giant scouts is right here in the center of this bridge. Either side, when placed in the center, is too narrow for a scout to get through to, so they'll tend to dogpile on this gun. There will be two or three of them sometimes. The soldier or whatever will jump up to help you deal with them. They'll go down. If this falls as well, then you pull the gun back to about right here. It accomplishes the same effect, and then after that, it's out of your hands. There's really nowhere else that you can body block with your sentry after they get past this point. It's up to your scout or soldier to chase. Another place that you can block if they come from inside the hangar bay, you can put your gun right here. This is a really bad place to put your sentry gun unless you're specifically blocking the scouts, but be ready to pull it out as soon as that job is done, because your gun will take so much damage there and it'll be really hard to repair quickly. Another place that you can put your gun is where it is right here. If you've watched the heavy video, these spots will look familiar. These are the same places that the heavy can stand to body block. You can put your gun as well. The two are more or less interchangeable. This isn't a bad place. It's a better placement for a longer term than right here, because it's usually not the first thing that the robots see, but it still accomplishes the goal of body blocking. Another place that you can put the gun to body block is like right here. That will usually buy you a few seconds, and then after that, it becomes pretty much the same as the spots that are up here. If you're not dealing with scouts, this is probably the primary position that you're going to want to put the gun. If you're dealing with lots of demo men coming from up top or lots of scouts up top and your team's busy down in the bottom, you want to move your gun a little bit away from the edge so that it only fires on these things and doesn't split its attention between things in the pit and things up here. Again, this is a better position to this if there are lots of small robots coming from up top.
I'm moving this.
If you get forced back to A, those are really the only positions that you'll want to keep your gun up front, is either right here or right here if you're dealing with things up top. You can put it right here, but it's usually not a great idea. I mean, if your team is congregated right here for whatever reason, they're dealing with a threat up here, then you can put the gun over here.
Yeah, there wasn't getting any
this
lighter.
Is kind of a fallback position for if the demo up top become too overwhelming, because it lets a heavy class stand right here and spam them out, and then this picks off the stragglers. This is very much a fallback position, though. I wouldn't leave my gun here. This is the position that your gun goes to if this fails. If you lose the A position, you're almost always going to want to put your gun right up in here. Notice that you will have a health and ammo pack for your use, while your dispenser, will remember, is down by the notice sign. This gun's going to take a lot of damage, and just like dispensers and teleporters and every other building that you have, the further back your team gets pushed on Manhattan, the harder it's going to be for you to do your job successfully, because there become less and less areas for you to put your gun or your buildings safely. The reason you want to put your gun up here if you get pushed back to A is because engineers or scouts will try to run up this ramp. They will usually not try to path that way. They'll try to come up this ramp and build on top of these crates or down in there. This gun will prevent them from doing that. Something else you can do is you can put your gun down here by this mound. This isn't a bad place at all because it gives it partial cover, but it can shoot over this. You can also try to move it over a little bit, like right here is a pretty good spot because it the robots don't see it when they initially drop down, but it can still shoot them. And it allows you to get more benefit from your dispenser because you don't have to jump down and walk all the way back around. So in order of best place to put the gun, I would say that on top of these crates is probably the best, followed by where the gun is right there. If you're forced to body block a giant scout in a pinch, for whatever reason, I don't know. Giant scouts, if they come from this gate, like to go through here, and so you can typically block them for a few seconds with the gun here, but it will usually result in your gun going down because the scouts can't go around or jump over it from this position. They're too big, and so they'll destroy your gun as a consequence. This is only good for blocking scouts. It's a one-trick pony. It makes your gun useless otherwise because it can't see over this mound. It's not good. On top of the crates first, then over here, and back here if you must block a giant scout from A.
Heavy load coming through.
If you get pushed back even farther, you're probably going to want to put your gun up here. Is not a bad place. It's of course going to take tons of damage. Because it just is. The further you get pushed back, the harder it becomes for you. If you don't want to put it there, you can put it down here. That's not bad. However, the downside of this area, or of this, despite taking less damage from spam, you don't cover the top anymore, and engineers really love to sneak up here and build enemy sentry guns, and that spells doom for most of the rest of your team, especially the scout. And the medic. A scout, because he can't effectively collect money when, against a sentry's knockback, and the medic's shield is only one directional. We'll talk about that in the medic video. So he'll get shot from behind and he can't do anything about that. So guns up here is probably the best because you've got your ammo and health to yourself, and you deny the rooftops from NGs that would want to build up here. Barring that, you can go down here for a safer bet. If you get pushed back even farther, just somewhere here or somewhere here is probably the best bet. You want to be able to kill things that come across this bridge, or come through here, or come through here. Your job is really to pick off stragglers. If you absolutely must, block a giant scout from this position.
I'm moving this.
The gun goes there. It's not going to block it for very long or very effectively. You can also get away with doing it right here, but that requires you to move very quickly because you have to run faster than a giant scout to beat him to this position. It's very difficult to do. There is really no way that you can block a giant scout from this way. It's not very effective. You can do it there, but you have to move so far and they're so fast. You're almost definitely not going to be able to do it, and your gun is completely useless for anything else in that position. So, by and large, you're going to want to put the gun either like right here so that it can shoot at the bridge and this entrance, but not get spammed out from afar, or in this position for the same reason. Either way, it doesn't look good for you, and your usefulness really starts to dwindle the further you get pushed back. That's pretty much the gun placement for the engineer. Provided everything goes well, your gun is going to be in like one of two places for the entire game. You're either going to put it, like I said, here, on the caution tape, on the ledge, that's an amazing spot for your gun, or you're going to be blocking something in this area right here. This isn't a bad place because it allows the gun to spam out things from over there, it's within its range, and it also gives it the ability to block scouts. The only downside is it can't really shoot much in the pit from there, so be advised. That pretty much does it for building placement for the engineer. I'll see you in a couple of minutes for closing thoughts. One final thing that we must talk about for engineer is sentry busters. Sentry busters are robots that cannot attack. They can only detonate themselves in a jihad fashion. They come when your sentry has dealt X amount of damage. The more damage your sentry deals, the more likely they are to start coming. They will always spawn from this gate. They'll drop down, they'll make their way around, go underneath the bridge here, come up to wherever your sentry gun is, then they'll squat and they'll explode. An effective way to deal with them is to let them get right up against your sentry gun, then when they squat, they're not going to move anymore, so you rescue Ranger out of the way, let them explode. Their area of explosion is roughly the size of this room right here. If one went off in here, pretty much everything in here would be dead. And note that I said everything, not everyone. Sentry busters can kill their own teammates, which is not functionally useful, but it is hilarious. Your medic friend may be chasing it to farm Ubercharge, more on that in the medic video, but as a rule of thumb, detonate a sentry buster away from your teammate. You have the ability to dictate where the buster goes off. If you pick up your gun, the sentry buster will follow you. Bait it away until it gets to a place where it's not going to deal any damage. Right here is usually a good spot here on the ramp. You'll meet it coming up, touch it, and then it'll squat. Run back and it'll explode where you were. Wherever it makes contact with your sentry, regardless of whether you have it picked up or not, that's where it's going to explode. Also, you'll want to caution your team not to shoot a sentry buster, or if you're watching this video and have the intention of playing another class, don't shoot a sentry buster, because if a sentry buster's health gets low enough, it will just explode wherever it is if its health reaches zero. You should really try to prevent this, because a lot of times where that place is right there on that button. And if you've watched any of the other class videos, you know that's where your team congregates, and it's not unusual for if a buster goes off here for it to kill three people. It's a mess. And your dispenser, too, most of the time. It's not pretty. It's not good. Don't shoot sentry busters. Try to blow them up in a controlled fashion by picking up your gun, bumping the buster, letting it squat, and it blows up right there.
That was getting heavy.
Next, we'll talk about how to deal with sentry busters on Rottenburg. Here we are at the front on Rottenburg. By and large, sentry busters on Rottenburg are easier to deal with than they are in Manhattan, simply because of where your gun tends to be, or where busters tend to get blown up unintentionally, relative to the rest of your buildings or your teammates where they can do harm. If a buster gets blown up, it'll usually be like right there if a heavy has like crits on it or something, or it'll get blown up over there, both of which are out of range of your dispenser, which would be right here. And over there, there's almost guaranteed to be no one over there except maybe a dead ringering spy who's escaping, or maybe a scout who's picking up cash. Either way, the damage is fairly minimal for an uncontrolled explosion like that. If it blows up right there, it is fairly likely to take out a couple members of your team unless they can hightail it out of there. Like I said, it's usually best to just ignore sentry busters and detonate them in a controlled fashion by dictating where you bump into them with the gun. That said, where do you want to bump into them with the gun? Well, either right there, just leave the gun where it is, wait for the buster to come up to it, and pull it back, wait for the buster to blow up, and then immediately go back in and put it back down. Alternatively, you can pull it back into the tunnel, detonate it in here. Nobody ever comes in here unless they're really screwed. Detonate it in there. Or if you are very aggressive, you can take it up here and detonate it somewhere behind the rock and blow it up there. That's usually not a good idea, though, because there's almost always robots coming through here, and removing the gun removes the area denial that would stop them from getting through the tunnel. So it's usually much better to detonate here or here. If the robots push back past here, the only spot that I'm going to say is worth talking about is if your gun is in this position and a buster is coming, pull it out and detonate it somewhere up here on the hill. I would stand on this side so that you block line of sight from projectile classes from the tunnel, blow it up, go back down, put your gun down. Getting pushed back any further than that, just use your best judgment. There really aren't any set in stone places. Just make sure that none of your teammates get caught in the blast when you do so. And if they do, you should typically apologize for it. Sometimes it's your fault, sometimes they're just being dumb shits. Another thing that you may need to know, it's a piece of trivia. Between waves of MVM, when you get to go buy stuff at the shop, destroy your sentry gun and put down a new one. Like I said earlier, sentry busters spawn based on the amount of damage your sentry has done. Your sentry has done, as in the individual sentry. If you blow up the gun, you reset the counter. So it takes longer for the next buster to come and makes your life a little bit easier. That pretty much does it for building placement and how to play Engineer on Man vs. Machine. Like I said at the start of this video, Engineer is one of, if not the most intensive micromanagement classes in the game. This video is probably going to be something like half an hour or 40 minutes. It's taken easily that long to film. Incredibly fun, incredibly rewarding, incredibly necessary. Engineer is probably the only class that you absolutely must 100% run on the Two Cities tour. You can get away with some cheeky substitutions for other classes, but there is no substitute for the Engineer. Between the Dispenser and the Teleporter by themselves, no other class can do anything like that. So it is extremely difficult and extremely daunting, and you can do it if it's your first time, but be aware that you are expected to do a lot. You've got some Texan-sized shoes to fill. Beyond that, if you have any questions, feel free to ask them in the comments, and I'll do my best. I've been Cruza, you've been wonderful, and I'll see you in-game. Howdy, partner.